we wanted, I have 5 books of poetry published, 4 books then, 5 books now. And I'd written about Gertrude Stein, and Michael made the painting over there for the Gertrude Stein cover. So I was doing something that I was calling like historical poetry, that I was going into the minds of the different poets, artists that were of that time. And during this trip, we went to, in Florence, we went to the Brownings area. And we thought, okay, well, I'll write about Ronald Browning and his wife, Elizabeth Barrett. And we went to a, this is just a little aside, but why I wrote this book. So we go to the English cemetery, and there's a nun there. And she's taking us around, and we see her, Elizabeth. And she said something like, oh, you're going to write about Robert? He killed me. He was a prick. And this was a nun, and I was like, wow. So then I thought, I don't really know if I want to write about him. So we ended up back in Venice. And the last day of our trip, I said to my husband, you know, we haven't gone to the Peggy Guggenheim Museum. I don't really like modern art, but let's just show up to see what it's like. And after seeing all the Venetian and Florence art and that kind of period art, we go into the Guggenheim Museum, and I was like, it's so airy, it's so beautiful. Everything just opened up to me. And I didn't realize when I got home that I was going to write a book about Peggy. And I thought she was like a hero when I started reading about the disparity between the men and the women, you know, the women, the whole thing. How she saved art from the Jews, from the Nazis coming in to take away the art. And all that, I had to write about that. Most of the stuff in my book has been really well researched. I'll read a couple of poems for you. And it's based on the characters that she met and that she knew, like Ezra Pound. And so I'll read a couple of poems, The Beauty is in Patience. I broke my Peggy Guggenheim glasses. When I was wearing these, everybody said, wow, I didn't intend to do it. But, you know, I wanted you to see. She's very much, I really got into her character. And I went to the Seligman Center right over in Chester, you know. I told them about this. And they were like, typical. I mean, they were like, well, she was, she tried to, blackmail Kurt because she won one of his paintings. I'm like, wait, she saved Jews, she saved art, and you're worrying about what happened, you know, all these years ago. I just thought it was kind of offensive. So I wrote my book.
She
helped to bring him here.
Yeah.
She helped to bring him here. It was in one of the scenes.
Oh, yes. I mean,
and actually, Max Ernst was up here, too.
I can't believe
he was one of the people that visited Seligman Center.
I can't believe that. Even now, she's thought of it such a way. I mean, one of the women there, when I went over there, said, but she was promiscuous. And I said, wait a minute. She saved these lives. She did everything. That's what you're focusing on? I was really annoyed about it. So anyway, I wrote it La Dogaressa, because they called her La Dogaressa, because that's the wife of the Doge. And so it was kind of mocking her, because she had a snout nose, you know. And they were not very respectful to her. And the first poem in my collection is a cantoon, which is repeating. I just want you to know I'm doing it on purpose. It's a, you know, a fixed form poem that has to be in a certain, like doing a crocheted blanket, you have to do it in a certain way. So the epigraphs that I'm using in here are from like real people's lives and what they said. And I'll start out, and the picture in here is from Venice, from the her palace. And I'm selling the books, you know, I'm bringing some of them next year to Venice with me because I thought they'd be interested. They said, well, there's kind of a hang up with, you know, family and how she's perceived, and they want to review the book. I'm like, what are you doing, Mom? But I didn't say anything bad about her in my view. But anyway, it starts out, La Dogaressa Cantoon, and the quote, the epigraphs, I won't keep saying that, but I can, you know, add to the poem. Where I was still told to my face that modern art can only be loved by Jews, Peggy Guggenheim. kids throw dead kittens in my garden like rain petals. I am a Jewess in a town of Catholic ghosts. My babies do not bark unless there is a reason. They carry dead kittens like a trophy or a bomb. I am their Jewess in a town of Catholic ghosts. They taunt me with Dogaressa and think my nose is snout. They carry dead kittens like a trophy or a bone. Every night in Venice, I go to sleep alone. They taunt me with Dogaressa and think my nose is snout. I try to ignore them, serve up warble soup and crackers. Every night that it rains, I go to sleep alone. The gardener and I mulch our blossoms with soft, striped fur. I try to ignore them, serve up warble soup and crackers. My babies do not bark unless there is a reason. The gardener and I mulch our flowers with soft, striped fur. Children throw dead kittens in my garden like rain petals. When I read that they were doing that to her, I had to write a poem about it, because how cruel is that, right? Especially after World War II. Okay, the Vestal Lady of Venice. She met the beat poets, Gregory Corso and Kerouac and all those different Allen Ginsberg. And she said they were very rude to her, actually. But she formed a relationship with Gregory Corso, and she gave him one of her watches. And he was quite smitten with her, but he was like 30 years old and she was in her 60s. And, you know, he didn't want to have an affair with her, but he really loved her in his own way. This is called The Vestal Lady of Venice. And this is another epigraph. Gregory Corso said it. But if a girl were possible as I am possible, then marriage would be possible. I told her she was old with memories, but the truth was when the moon sings with dreams and twilight her wedding veil, I see her completely as she is, and that is entirely alone. She collected us like she collects butterflies or dogs, frames and strange glasses. I think the world is blurred to her. Perhaps she likes it that way. She needs friends, not those creepy painters. She needs her daughter to wave her wand and turn her back into a mother. She's a monarch flitting through an empty palace. The last time I saw her, during one of those wild soirees attended by vampires, she was bathing in the moonlight. From the gondolier she hired to ferry us around, as if we were on the River Styx. I could pretend for a moment she was young. We were both the same age. I watched her rise from the fanging moon water as if to leave her mermaid tail behind to join her tortured guests. They catcalled and waved her back into their amber lit lives. It were as if she were hiding there among the bottles, a sequin that had fallen off one of her tiaras, or maybe she was a tear. I looked at the watch she had given so freely from her own hand and prayed for us both, that there would be time, sweet lady, we could shrug off our tired human skin, rattlers that devour the light, that together drift off like one of her Chagall couples into a flame red sky, a sailor's best omen, or like that apple that tempts us, leads us instead into paradise, a place where time is simply a fool's notion. Okay, I wrote about cigars because I was thinking of her dad going down, and his male, whatever you call
ballet
it.
Ballet or something, wasn't he?
Ballet, yeah.
I think so.
He said he was black. He was Indian. He was, you know, of color. And they wouldn't let him on the lifeboat. Right? Mm-hmm. So he basically said that I'm going to go down like a gentleman and I'm just going to die. Okay, so this is the quote. Guggenheim and his valet were last seen seated in deck chairs in the foyer of the grand staircase, sipping brandy and smoking cigars. I know we have always been mocked as a gentleman's plaything, but the night we were honorably discharged and turned into ash, like those two should have been, 30 years later as old fools, fat and costly, we had some moments of grace. They sparked life. Our purpose was to burn out and die with them. They were in their best Brooks Brothers smoking jackets, debating the few hours left as their Egyptian servant was not boarding the first-class lifeboat. If there be heaven, let us wind up in heroes' mouths. We You're of little consequence in your dreamer's world. The dignity of being needed so earnestly, used and not discarded. After we were born, we became so important that in early days, a man read to us each morning. Humble beginnings, saved by literature and learning. We began in factories where only the chosen, the parted, can read. Our imaginations ran wild in belief that this story could have ended differently had they wanted. That a count is equal to a sailor or a slave. Mercy and hope are more than mere words. Our patrons chose not to spend their money to purchase their souls. They could have saved themselves and decided that each woman or child is precious to the earth, that in the end all human beings are equal and not defined by coin or by character, that it was their duty as gentlemen to be taken by the sea. Okay, so this is a poem for trinkets, and I should have mentioned that these earrings came from the Guggenheim Museum because that's some of the art, right? And she, if you remember in the movie, she was talking about the tangi earrings, mm-hmm. and they showed them the oval earrings. I wore one of my tangi earrings and one made by Calder in order to show my impartiality between surrealistic and abstract art. Hey. She said she was impartial to us, but I suspect otherwise. Mm-hmm. When we were alone, I knew she preferred me to my angular brother. I'm an oval, you see, and until the day she died, her life was a skeletal subterfuge. Often she disappeared into me, walked among my sepia columns. I was a safe place for her. She said hello to my cobweb branches, held me like a lover, murmured my shell ear. My twin was a blue iris. I was brown. She longed not to be held prisoner in a jubilated world. After she would disappear into me and return back, summoned by the clink of glasses, fork on dessert plate, to those dreary drunken parties, I missed her then. Called her. She professed an affinity to his madness, his unsteady walks. His floors shot out from under him. If he glanced up, he could become confused. I say her life was unsteady enough to want the terraforma of me. There among those savage artists, she was a lightning rod scepter, always releasing herself to an unreliable sky. Heaven for her was the collecting of odd things. Jolie laid, the French say, which means other beautiful. He shows around a pimpled virgin's neck. Oh, the messiness of beauty. The polar joy lad sniffed at her clumsy grace. To me, she was a witchy Prospero. I knew she coveted a round life to a willowy dowser stick. I was her scribe, bowl, a landscape to disappear into, her evening glow, a fortune in a steady hand. I was the framed magic spell she wore it to bed at night. Hopeful that I would promise her a happy ending. Okay, so she wrote, she wanted that silver bedhead. She asked Calder to make her that bedhead, right? Silver veil of hair, an aged mermaid, waterfall of fish and plant. Make me a headboard of someone's dreams. Fashion a water glow cooker that percolates over us, pumping pulsing vaporous thoughts, escaping into a static lake bead. When our footprints dissolve into froth and sand, bubble into the corners of a beach blue mouth, then we will know the truth of it. People love filth. Red insects, my souls are common ones. Lift my imagination into the wild air. Never shackle me to the harness of a messy bed. My headboard breathes and silverfish carry me downstream. Men, I use them all, sad darlings, in order to perform a scurrilous trance. We are butterflies in moonlight, and to each drifter's arms let us begin to dance. Okay, and this one is Sue's favorite poem. So, think about Jackson Pollock and the relationship she had with Shannon. I continued to get further away from the usual painter's tools, such as easel, palette, brushes, etc. used us, but he used us to create beauty. Before our life with him, we were fluid, a possibility, something that could only become. When he released us in the air and popped off our tops like a cork, we shivered in anticipation. We wanted to wrinkle and dry before him, but it was too late for regrets. He produced gaiety, whisked us bodily around and around. We pirouette, we rumbled. We circled him like a coven of angels. We spilled our guts for him. My friend smeared the floor and his body with us. He jabbed into us over and over with sticks, with screwdrivers, with anything he could find. He was cocksure. He knew how we liked to be touched. He knew us like the sweat on the forehead of my kind jaw, like the dewy slop off a St. Bernard's tongue. He seduced us. We seduced him. We covered him in a wild array of vines of every blue flower. We took him to our tin chest and we worshipped him. He emptied us, then dented and rejected. He lined us all over the room while we stayed barren and discarded, but close to our other selves. In the end, we were in paradise. We were evolved in a matter of minutes, in a matter of days. We became attached to our new lives. We entertained each other, a brave new world. Joyous, we held each other tight and knew that by squandering us, he had somehow saved us. We knew by our deaths we were never given false hope. We worshipped him as our new God. All right, well, I wrote about Lee Krasner, and that was the wife of Jackson Pollock. She had a rough time with Jackson Pollock, as you can tell, right? He was kind of maniac. So when I saw Lee Krasner's art, it's really almost as good in a way as Pollock's. So I wrote about her. And this poem actually is in an encyclopedia for Jewish women, so I was excited that they accepted it. I don't paint nature, I am nature, Jackson Pollock. Another time, dunes dissolving like tears as we wrap each other in blankets of regret. Jack sips his iced tea, crushes ice like he wants to pour it into a flask, but may not carry. He is sober, that is all. Brilliant and sober, even drunk, he bests them, even in bed. The cooning knows it. He wrote in from Cody, Wyoming, last in me and in the world with his bare heads of paint. Even Peggy, with her crotchless panties, has an eye for art. Except mine, I am that LK person she despises. I used to walk in two steps behind. You would think it would help that we are members of the same tribe, self-loathing Jewish poor. Still, I trust her more than the others to keep my beast in line. Shrinks tell him to drink all he wants. No one understands a real alcoholic. He is a real artist, this one, and so am I, if talent counts for anything. If he is Caliban, that would make me Sicarus, and what then? Numo would have hated me for translating that line on my studio wall as the beast I call my own. And yet he didn't know Jack, did he? For that matter, did anyone? Okay, I'm going to read about Big Yin because I thought that was quite distressing to read about how she, right? This is called Piggy Wuhan, and the epigraph is Frida Kahlo. I paint flowers so they will not die. Since I was born in Switzerland, do you think I could aim for neutral, not fast nor slow? Given my circumstances, that is impossible. I'm guilty of various things. Mother hands out love like giving us a rough diamond, precious only to her. I attempted like Eve, but I know better than to set up the bribes. That story ended in hardship. With freedom comes knowledge, and mother is the freest kite in the sky. I want to be like her, but her dogs are her children. Royal, obedient, dedicated to her wings. Have you seen the palace? It is what my paintings are, when they are the most behaved. Naive, primitive, lowly pure. We are her ambrosial children. In her exhibition of 31 women, I was number 18. Notice the lack of commitment? visually, that number is a mess. Was either curvy, tan body, or the spiked halter? Why could she not settle for one or the other? Hear the explanation. Convenient, your birthday is 18, darling. Can't you see the sense? Mother always puts on a show. I am both still straight and curvy and circus brown. If only she could have loved me unconditionally without complications. Maybe I could have left the drama and loved the whole of me, wily labor, innocent mouse. And so she died in Paris March 1st, 1967, after overdose. And they never were sure how exactly what had happened to her. So she was friends with Ezra, and I'm always defending Ezra Pound because he was just like Peggy in the fact he was always, you know, supporting the artists and supporting the arts, that T.S. Eliot had. So I like to talk about Ezra Pound in a good way. The real trouble with war is that it gives no one a chance to kill the right people. Ezra Pound. In Italy, after my brimstone chats, they kept me in a 6x6 death cell, a cage really, because my poems were such dangerous creatures, they feared they would escape and sneak out to the free world, growling and hissing from the alleys of Pisa. A tall shadow leaned over them. They were unable to mind. I urged them forward. They bit the hands that fed me. I was trialed and I was tribulated. Worse luck, they denied me books, pens, and laces on my shoes, as if my righteous old man's body would step right straight to hell from a cat's cradle's noose. In short, I was fucked. Why did I denounce that Kent Roosevelt and his covet of bank reverse? I needed the money. Their enemies paid me well. I became a rasping, buzzing hornet and a capitalistic arsonist. But I also do well by my friends. In 1954, Ham, who owed me, said, it's a good year to release poets. I responded, all of America is an insane asylum. Yet they released me from the bug house anyway, dropped the treason nonsense. Like Pythos, all the worst parts of me escaped St. Elizabeth's bug house. Like a swarm of arrogant stingers, I landed back in Rapallo, a plague on Italy's vines. Finally, they recognized I was not only a lunatic, but a moron, and with that I won many prizes and medals. One of my greatest accomplishments, however, was overcoming my stupid suburban prejudice of anti-Semitism. Also, I am a champion tennis player. Just ask Peggy Guggenheim, who I nailed on the court time and time again, who says, Ezra's a good player, but he crows like a rooster whenever he makes a good stroke. Okay, so I wrote Isadora and Yoko Ono.